Welcome to episode 195 of the Reformed Brotherhood. I'm Jesse.
And I'm Tony, and we are proud members of the Society of Reformed Podcasters. Hey, brother.
Hey, brother.
Hey, father.
Hey.
So we are here in beautiful Enfield, New Hampshire. We're sitting out on the deck listening to some dude mow his lawn and record a podcast. And we have with us our earthly father, not our heavenly father, although he's with us too, to record a podcast. So it's pretty exciting.
That's correct. So we're all together. We're in person. And I think it's fair to say that my father is our pastor in residence, right, of this podcast, like the official pastor of the Reformed Brotherhood podcast. Are you comfortable with that title?
Yeah, that's a nice title. Thank you.
So I'm going to be posting his email for all your pen. I'm just kidding. I won't do that. Yeah. But we're excited because, you know, we always try to make sure we say that we're not pastors. We're not your pastor. You should talk to your pastor. And we love to have pastoral voices on the show. Yes. So we're excited to have an actual pastor to join us for this discussion.
Yes. And we went back and checked the last time that you were on the podcast with us. It was like 18, right?
Yeah. So it was like 2 years ago.
It's been a long time. So I'm glad to have you back, Dad. And anybody can go back and listen to that one as well, because that was also a really, that was a great podcast, actually. Yeah. So what are we doing today?
So we're gonna springboard off a question we received about, it's kind of a complicated question, but the idea is, you know, as Reformed Christians with a Reformed hermeneutic, we look at the scriptures, particularly prophecy in the Psalms, but not exclusively, and we see that certain things have dual fulfillment. So for example, when we have a psalm that's talking about David and David's earthly reign or his kingship or a battle that he's in or something like that, we look at that and say, well, that's about David. Right. But then we also look at it and say, well, that's also about Jesus. So this came from our good friend Jimmy, who asked the question. Jimmy. I don't know when it was, as we've got a big backlog. And he wanted to know, like, how do we wrestle with that? How do we, thinking about the historical grammatical method, how do we wrestle with the idea that the original human author maybe didn't actually have that in mind? And what do we do with that? And how, I think another question that he didn't ask, but that comes up, is how do we safeguard then against kind of flying off into these sort of fanciful interpretive methods that like the Roman Catholic Church is really known for, or some of our less careful exegetes in the Protestant tradition too.
Right. But first, we got affirmations and denials.
Yes.
And everybody's all in. So you mind if I kick us off then?
Let's do it.
So I'll start. We'll go around. We'll each do an affirmation. We'll go around each do denial. So I'll start with the affirmation. I'm affirming with horseradish. Only because, have I done this before? I don't think I mentioned this before in the podcast. But just for lunch, I had this delicious sandwich and just put, what was it? Was that horseradish spread?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is that what that was? Yep. Yeah, this is really good. I think any kind of horseradish is really delicious to me, but if you get it in spreadable form, you can put it on chips, you can put it on sandwiches, but I'm a dry sandwich kind of guy, so I usually just two pieces of bread and meat and cheese. And so I don't really do mayonnaise or mustard so much, but this for me is like the perfect, because it's like horseradish is not spicy in the same, like a traditional sense. I don't know, what is it, like sinus spicy? I don't know what you call that.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
Yeah. So that's what I'm affirming with. And I'm sure there's multiple brands. Do you know what brand that one was?
No, I don't. But they'll sponsor us if we can get the name on here.
There we go. There you go.
All right, Tony, what are you affirming?
So I'm affirming with harmonics. And so Jesse, when he comes to visit, he relieves me of my normal duties to play guitar during the worship service, which I greatly appreciate because it's nice to sort of be able to step back a little bit. And you did this amazing little thing during the prelude. It was like a finger picking style of 10,000 Reasons,
yes,
right, by Matt Redman, right?
Yes.
And there's the spot where the guitar stops, and usually people just like mute it, and then they tap the guitar, like that's the traditional way to do it. And Jesse just hits this perfect little bing. And the first thing that came into my mind is there's a gif out there of Michael Scott. And in the context of the show, he's like hearing someone talk, like say good things about him in the other room. And he leans back. He's got this big smile on his face. He's like, ah! And that's the facial expression of the harmonic that Jesse hit.
I'm glad. Yes. I try to work that in whenever I can, because it's not often that you can do the harmonic thing. It's kind of, you know, like a little
thing. It's a little kitschy,
thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. You went kitschy, I went niche. All right, well, we know exactly where we stand with respect to harmonics on that one. So, all right, Dad, kicking it over to you. What are you affirming?
All right, so I'm affirming the Puritan Reform Journal. I was actually reading it when I had to stop because they were begging me to be on the podcast.
This is true.
But the Puritan Reform Journal, I love it. I like how it's organized. It has a systematic theology section, a pastoral theology. It's very good. If you mention to Joel Beakey my name, you get a 10% discount on a subscription.
Oh, man.
So that's what I'm affirming.
We're going to get sued now.
I love it. So how would somebody go about getting a subscription? What do you do to go find this?
I would go to the Puritan Reformed website of the seminary there, and then there is a drop down that has the journal.
So what, give people an idea.
It's published two times a year.
Okay.
I think it's like $30, might even be cheaper for students.
Okay. And so, give people an example, like what you were just reading, because you have it in front of you actually right here. So I'm curious, what was the article you were just reading?
I was just reading an article on Bovink and baptism. Now, as a Baptist, I wouldn't agree with Bovink, but he was talking about the difference that even among Presbyterians, the understanding of does this refer to a baptized child is completely seen as saved or not, and sort of approached it. It was an interesting perspective.
Interesting. Man, we could do a whole show just on that right now.
Yeah, that was actually one of the main differences, one of the reasons he wouldn't go to teach at Kuyper School initially, was because Kuyper was very strong into presumptive regeneration, and Bovink was like, I'm not so sure about that. Yeah. So. Yeah.
Well, that's good. You balance those out. That's a strong affirmation right there.
Yeah, that's good stuff.
There's actual meat on that as opposed to me talking about horseradish. All right, so round of denials. So we are in New Hampshire, which is beautiful, but there's one thing that I forgot about because we haven't been here this time of year for a couple years now. So I went for a run this morning, and I thought that I was at least fast enough to at least avoid this particular problem, but it turns out I'm slow and much older now, but also they're just vociferous, and like deer flies are what I'm denying against. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if other people have those in other parts of the country. I'm not even sure what they're after when they're after me. Right. But, like, they just don't stop. Like, they're
persistent.
They're really persistent, and they're big, and they're just super annoying. So I'm just denying against deer flies. Somebody out there has to have had this experience as well.
They'll carry off children.
Yeah.
In this area.
Wasn't it Erasmus that writes when he was doing his Greek New Testament? He writes about how he was being attacked by, like, bugs, and he thought they were demons from the pit. I'm pretty sure it was Erasmus.
I see how you can make that jump, because if you get in a fog or a cloud of deer flies, it's pretty awful. So what do you do to fight the deer flies? Is there anything you can actually do?
Well, that's why I walk with a hat, to swat them away temporarily and just keep moving. Don't stop. That's the worst thing, is if you stop.
I go with the John Knox style, and I carry a broadsword around with me to fight off the deer flies. Yeah.
All right, good. All right, well then, I'll kick it over to you for denial then.
So this is like the universal denial of our time, but I'm denying COVID-19, and I'm denying it for a very specific reason. Obviously, like, it's terrible, and we should just deny it in general. But I love that we're here in New Hampshire, but we should be in New Jersey, right? So we do this family vacation every year. Last year we did Beachcast. It was a lot of fun.
That's true.
And we had to cancel our plans this year. So I'm thankful that we can still get together, that we can still enjoy each other's company, but it's not quite the same as sitting out on the beach. Rather than, like, a lawnmower that I have to try to edit out of the show right now, we should be trying to edit out, like, seagulls and, like, I don't know, beach noise. I don't know, people with Jersey accents. I'm not sure.
Oh, wow. And we just went there.
We did go there. Sorry to anyone if you're from New Jersey.
So now I'm really curious about what you're going to deny, Dad. Because the affirmation was so strong, and I feel like you've taken this very serious, as you probably... We probably take it more serious.
Yeah,
like
we should,
But we went with just bugs, and, well, COVID's a very serious denial. And it's
but not going to the beach is not that serious,
So, all right, so go ahead. What do you got?
So mine's probably not a popular one, but it's a two-form denial.
This is good.
Now I have a smartphone. Like, I love my phone. I do use it. But I'm denying people who are always on their phone, because nobody's that important. And then people who talk excessively loud when they are on their cell phone, like in a public place.
So has this happened to you recently? I feel like there's a story here. Or is this just a cumulative?
It happens occasionally. It's a cumulative. It's a pent-up sort of denial.
Yeah. The worst is when you have someone who's talking about something that's, like, not pleasant. Like, it's not something you want to hear about. I schedule colonoscopies for a living. That's what I do for a job. And I frequently get people that at the end of the call, they're like, oh, I got to go. I'm in the line at the grocery store. They're like telling me all about their gastroenterology symptoms.
Now, I should add, you on that one. In this area, we have a big lake. And once in a while, people will post who live along the lake. They'll post things to the community saying, please be aware that when you're out on the water, your voice carries. We don't need to hear about what you did last night. We don't need to hear about whose relationship you're
That's
with.
That's funny.
So that obviously there are other denials. Yeah, yes. I just read one this week. Someone was again warning people. You need to realize if you're out on the water, we can hear everything you're saying.
That's amazing.
Has that ever happened to you where you've heard somebody talking?
I don't think so. I mean, I'm pretty careful what I say.
Yeah. No, I mean, have you ever heard anybody talking, like, who's out on the water?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
It's pretty easy. I mean, it does carry a long ways.
Have you guys ever had this happen to you? And I know this is a common thing where you're in we're all men, so it'd be a men's restroom.
Oh, yeah.
And you think somebody's talking to you that you don't know, and you realize only too late that they have like an earbud in or they're on the phone, some kind of wireless thing.
I've had that where someone's walking toward you in a store and they'll say, hi. And I'll say, hi. And I realize they're on there.
You do the thing where you like you reach up to wave and then you realize they're not talking and you itch your head.
That's probably part of my denial.
That's a good one. We've never done that.
No, I don't think that's new.
Yeah, that's a very good one.
The moral of the story is if you're in the middle of the lake spending too much time on your cell phone, be careful what you're talking about.
Well, I mean, there's a spiritual connection here, right, with this, because like part of Jesus' teaching, going out onto just pushing out onto the shore a little bit, getting that natural amplification of his voice, just goes to show that you just got to be careful what you're saying, I guess.
That's right.
You're on a boat.
That's right.
In any kind of body of water.
Yeah.
And how much quicker could Christ have gotten at Peter if Peter had a cell phone?
That's true. It's kind of like Philip, who didn't need a cell phone because he just like teleported from one place to another. Yeah. That's pretty cool.
That's true. You know what I was also thinking about recently was I was out again for a run, and it was in a community park area. And there, of course, weren't many people around, but there was a gentleman who was, he was pushing a stroller. So he had at least, I think he had a little child, maybe toddler age in the stroller. And he walking along the water, and he had a dog as well with him on a leash, a big dog. Mm-hmm. And I passed him several times just because of the route. And each time I looked, I noticed that it's a beautiful day out. He's walking along the water, and all the time he's just on the phone pushing. Sure, and I just thought it was a wonderful reminder to, like, wherever you are, be fully there, like, to appreciate what God has given us and to go out and enjoy things. Yeah. It's easy to get caught up in just having a device with you or something else, or even just listening to stuff in your ears as opposed to listening to it in any other way. But you can just get caught up in losing yourself in the moment. There's something to be said for trying to put ourselves purposely where we're at and just to enjoy without distraction.
Just like to take this time to remind everybody that occasionally I will figure out that Jesse has been texting somebody during recording the podcast. So frequently it's to ask his wife to bring him another beer.
That's good.
Which is great. But sometimes it's like just a random conversation with my wife about something she's painting. That's the most common one.
That's true.
So be in the moment, Jesse.
I found myself instantly convicted now for a good reason. Well, with that said, that was the best affirmation denials we've ever done. So thanks, Dad.
So today's topic is, it touches a lot of different things, right? It touches hermeneutics. It touches on preaching. It touches on just general like Bible study. Like what do I do with this text? It touches a little bit on like the difference between even Reformed hermeneutics versus other branches of Protestantism, and then obviously Roman Catholicism, which has a much more robust kind of allegorical interpretive method. So I thought it would be good for us to like read through one of the Psalms that is probably the most classic example of this, and then I'm sure we'll talk about some passages in Isaiah later. But I'm looking at Psalm 22, which is like the classic text that you read it, and following the New Testament, there's no way you cannot see Jesus.
Right.
But before the New Testament, especially at the immediate time of writing, it's unlikely that people would have probably thought a lot about this in terms of really strong messianic overtones.
Right.
But it says, I'll read the superscript too, because it gives us a little bit of clue about what it was originally used for. So it says, "To the choir master, according to the Doe of Dawn, a psalm of David. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groanings? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. You are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. And you, our fathers, trusted, and they trusted, and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by mankind and despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They make mouths at me, they wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say, let him deliver them, or let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, for he delights in him. Yet you are he who took me from the womb. You made me trust you at my mother's breast. On you I was cast from my birth. And from my mother's womb you have been my God." So I'm not going to read through the whole thing, but we get to verse 16 is where it really starts to seem like, oh yeah, this is definitely about the crucifixion.
Right.
"For dogs encompass me, a company of evildoers encircle me. They have pierced my hands and feet. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." So this passage is, you know, not all of the Psalms are cited in the New Testament. But when we see the Psalms cited in the New Testament, predominantly they're interpreting them in light of them being about Jesus, right? That's all throughout Hebrews. It's all throughout Christ's own interpretive method with the Psalms, is that they're about him. And then, right, of course, he says on the road to Emmaus that all the law and the prophets, and then he says later in the passage, the law, the prophets, and the writings testify to and are about him.
Mm-hmm.
So how do we handle this? Like, we affirm as Reformed Protestants the historical grammatical method, but if we limit ourselves just to the historical grammatical method, we end up walking away, I think, with an interpretive method that sometimes kind of feels or maybe runs at odds with the way that Jesus and the apostles interpreted some of these passages.
Sure.
What do you think, Dad?
Well, I think in the discussion, obviously there's a big hermeneutical assumption, which I would say is true, that we're looking at, that the New Testament does further explain and interpret the Old Testament for us.
Right.
I guess with the question that the individual sent in, my only thought on that is that maybe the emphasis is in the wrong place. Like, rather than in form criticism or higher criticism, where we're trying to figure out the author's intent, we should be more focused on looking at the analogy of Scripture to help us interpret what it means.
Yeah.
So, like, if you were to take this passage and say you were teaching or preaching on it, what would be, like, your approach then in trying to, explain all of that to somebody, yeah, who you were expressing it to or unpacking the Scriptures?
Well, I think, you know, in any Psalms, first looking at what kind of psalm it is. Is it a lament? Is it personal? Is it corporate? You know, finding out what category it fits in, then looking at the superscription, kind of talking about that, presenting, obviously, historically, crucifixion wasn't even a form,
right,
of punishment or execution known to man then. So we can't be saying, well, David clearly was saying this. We can then, though, go through the parallels in the Gospels where comments are met and mentioned, what we know physiologically about crucifixion, and say, look, clearly that would be an example of, like, prophetic telescoping or partial fulfillment, where it's pointing to something way ahead.
Yeah. I mean, I think too, there's an assumption that I'm not always 100% sure where it comes from, that they didn't know that they were talking about the Messiah,
mm-hmm,
right? So when you look at rabbinical teaching on this passage particularly, it very quickly in the record, and the rabbinical record doesn't go that far back, but
right,
the earliest records we have of people commenting on this are probably the New Testament. But once you get outside of that, they very clearly thought it was about the Messiah. Mm-hmm. They just didn't think the Messiah was Jesus.
Right. Yeah.
And there are passages, I'll pull them up in a little bit here, but there are passages in throughout the Old Testament that seem to indicate that God was revealing more to the prophets about some of the future fulfillment than maybe we initially think. You know, Amos,
right,
what is it, Amos 3, I'll pull it up here, but Amos, one of the passages in Amos chapter 3, verse 7, he says, "For the Lord does nothing without revealing the secrets to his servants, the prophets."
Right, that's a verse.
So there's something there about the fact that the prophets, they're receiving special revelation that they're communicating to us in written form,
mm-hmm,
but there's more that's being revealed to them that they didn't communicate to us in written form that helps them to understand what they're writing.
Right.
So someone like Moses, who has this almost unprecedented, you know, experience and exposure to God, to think that he was writing things that seem clearly to be about the Trinity and that God didn't clue him into those, that he was totally ignorant. You know, he probably didn't have the full revelation of what was going on, but that he was totally ignorant to what the plurals in Genesis 1 mean seems a little bit like a presupposition that I don't know that is justified.
And I think that's some of what's embedded in Brother Jimmy's question. And actually, like, we should get into a little bit of that nuance there, because there is this idea, I think, sometimes where Christians can sense that they're on shaky ground if they're making these claims that of the prophetic telescoping, where there's something that's happening in near fulfillment and far fulfillment. But what if we're saying, well, I think sometimes we're afraid to ask, well, how much did David know? And does it matter that he knew or did not knew? So, like, in this case, what would you say? Like, does it matter to us that David knew or didn't know
I think there's two extremes. If you went to the extreme, well, they had to fully understand all the details before they could speak this and it would be truth, that's a dangerous extreme, because clearly that's not what Scripture teaches. Right. If you went the opposite, they have no idea, like as you were saying, Tony, the clearly rabbinic teaching, the Talmud, all talks about the expectation of Messiah. And that clearly is there from even Deuteronomy 18, when Moses is saying, you know, another one prophet will come. When he comes, you got to listen to him. So they clearly had that mindset behind them. I think, though, the question of how much they understood, if we focus just on that, and that's going to be a roadblock to us taking the passage and applying it or saying it's truth, that's a dangerous situation.
Right. I mean, so of course we're going to affirm that the scripture is inerrant and it's true, but it sounds like what we're saying is that the efficaciousness of what's being written there is not hindered by how trying to sort out how much David in this case knew, but clearly I'm getting from you guys, we're all coming to the sense that there was something there that God himself was imparting, perhaps a certain base level of knowledge in terms of what he's writing. But of course it doesn't matter that he didn't know the whole thing, because it's still true and still God's prophecy.
Could look at it from this perspective, and no analogy is perfect. You know, if you have a young child, you tell them you're getting in the car to go somewhere.
Yeah.
They understand enough to know what a car is. You get in it and it takes you somewhere, but they don't understand the mechanics. Now, maybe when they're older and they've studied it, or then they can understand, oh, this is how it works.
Yeah.
So that they understood the concept. And it's interesting when you think about this, you look at like 2 Peter 1, where it says no interpretation of prophecy was open just to man, which says to us that it is possible at times they did not, and I think in many cases, didn't have the full understanding of what this was, which is why they were walking by faith when they were teaching these things.
And that's a really good point, because I think, again, sometimes there's this sense that somehow it erodes the efficacy of Scripture to say, well, the people who are writing this, I'll say in the extreme, had no idea what they were writing. That, you know, like they were just writing to the time. It's as if God somehow, like, pulled a quick one and used what was also relevant then to something that was going to be relevant later on. But I love this idea of, like, they're writing in faith, that even represented in the actual articulation of the Scripture by the Holy Spirit through the voice of a man, but certainly, of course, carried along by the Holy Spirit, that even in that, there's a great act of faith that's happening, and that there's a trusting. So there's something there that the person perhaps transcribing these words is understanding, that God is doing a mighty work that is both here and also in the future, but they're satisfied with a faith that trusts that what God is articulating is something that's going to be both, like, eternally contemporary, useful now and useful later.
Yeah.
So I wonder, even with the questioner who raised the question, it'd be interesting to know what his understanding of inspiration is, because I would almost think if you were more the mechanical view of inspiration, where you're just kind of a mindless thing and this is poured in and you filter it back out, versus like the dynamic inspiration where it involves the author's personality, their experiences, if that also would predetermine where you might start going in this direction.
Yeah, you know, there was this big controversy at Westminster Seminary. Oh, man, it was probably 6, maybe 7 years ago, surrounding Peter Enns, right? Mm-hmm. And Peter Enns was a professor at Westminster Seminary. He has all the Reformed bona fides that you can have. And he started teaching that basically the New Testament authors took passages and changed their meaning, like classic liberal reader response, that the original meaning didn't matter. It was how the apostles kind of appropriated that text themselves. Right. And of course, there was a big controversy. There was professors that were let go and all sorts of issues. So that's one extreme where we can say like the original author had no concept. And you kind of talked about this earlier. But then there is sort of this other extreme where it's like Moses has a fully formed Trinitarian theology and David knew exactly who and when the Messiah was going to come. There's somewhere, you know, I'm not one of those people that always tries to find like the golden mean, like the middle of that spectrum is not always right. But there's somewhere between those two positions where people of faith reaching out in faith, they're able to understand that the immediate fulfillment is true. Right. When David's talking about these evildoers that are encircling him, that's true. And he's talking about his immediate circumstances. But I think that it would be silly to think that David didn't also understand that there was some future fulfillment of what was going on. Right. And, you know, I mentioned the superscript and I read that. A lot of times people gloss over those. But in this superscript, this was written to the choir master. Right. This was intended to be a song that was sung by the Israelites. And when you look at the songs that are explicitly indicated, the psalms that are explicitly indicated to be sung by the congregation, they tend to be these forward-looking messianic ideas.
Right.
Right. So it's a statement that the whole assembly of Israel is singing, you know, yearly on a cycle that ends up becoming this almost like this longing and this cry for the Messiah. And that's what's so paradoxical about some of pre-Christian Jewish religion is you almost wonder how they missed it in some ways. And it's interesting because if you look at the original Hebrew of this, it's kind of ambiguous between a couple different phrases. Mm-hmm. The Septuagint gets it the way that we see it. We take our reading from the Septuagint. But there are Jewish variants that appear, and the evidence looks like they've changed this psalm. So instead of saying, they pierced my hands and feet, it says, like a lion, they encircled me. So there's evidence that they actually understood that this had to do with some sort of like, you know,
too
like
close.
Well, but like there's evidence that they modified it. And this was the Masoretic text to actually point away from this messianic thing.
Right.
Because the idea of a Messiah who was going to be like shamed and killed suffering the way he was, suffering was so foreign to their mind at that point. There's evidence to actually change the text in order to accommodate that. So I think there's two assumptions in the question, maybe not in the question, but there's two assumptions that happen. That one, the original audience didn't have any concept of this stuff, mm-hmm. which I think we'll talk about some of the passages in a minute, but I think there's good biblical reasons to think that that's probably not the case. They had some sort of indication. But then there's also an assumption that nobody up until the Christian era interpreted these the way that I think is just bad historicity. Like the historical record seems to indicate people knew Psalm 22 is about the Messiah. People knew that Isaiah 53 is about the Messiah.
Right.
When Jesus brings up Psalm 110, right. he's not bringing up a question that the rabbis had never thought about when he says, how could David say to Messiah, how could the Messiah be David's son and David's Lord? He's not bringing up a question they had never wrestled with. He's bringing up a question to say, you guys know that this is an interesting passage that needs to be wrestled with. So I think those two assumptions, you know, if we're trying to figure out how do we handle this text, we need to first get behind those assumptions and realize that maybe they don't hold as much water.
Right. Well, that's one thing I wanted to ask you then, Dad, is given all those things we talked about, how there's often error in extremes, how do we kind of become balanced when we approach scriptures like this that we can understand them properly and also not go either too far in one direction or make too much about something or make too little about it?
Well, I mean, a couple ways. One is obviously if the Holy Spirit's job is to illuminate and enlighten God's word, and we're seeking to interpret it according to the Spirit, that should guide us against error and that we're testing everything against what Scripture says. I still kind of look at this and think it is a bigger hermeneutical issue because the question is not really the author's intent. What is God's intent?
Right.
And we can discern that by balancing, and as I said, using Scripture to interpret Scripture to make sure we're making the right connections there.
Yeah,
right.
So, I mean, that's where a broader knowledge of the Bible is important to interpret a text like Psalm 22 or Psalm 110, which is the most quoted psalm in the New Testament.
Right.
I mean, to be able to say, am I reading too much into this? I don't want to go off into allegorizing. And I think we do see extremes, and I'm sure you've had excellent podcasts on this, you know, of people who are, you know, afraid of reading Christ too much into every text.
Right.
You know, and that's an error. But also to neglect reading him into certain texts is also a dangerous error. Right.
Yeah, it's funny. I know that there's a huge amount of love for Spurgeon in this family, but I love that quote because I think it demonstrates that tendency that, like, you can actually take a passage. Now, we affirm the whole scripture is about Jesus, but that doesn't mean that every individual passage is specifically about Jesus or about Messiah. There's that quote from Spurgeon that's like, if you can't find Jesus in the text, then go through the hedge and find him or something like that. And he's saying, like, you can find Jesus everywhere. And so there is that tendency to say, like, you know, I've seen it done where people take, like, the genealogies. Actually, a really common example I find online is if you look at the meanings of the names in the first genealogy of Noah, like, some of the names, if you sort of, like, line them out to be a sentence, seem like a gospel presentation. And so people look at that and they're like, well, this passage is all about Jesus, this genealogy, because look at how the names work. And it ends up being almost like a secret code you have to discern to try to figure out. And in reality, like, yeah, maybe there's something there. Maybe that's a cool little nugget that God put in there for those who are studying. But, like, in actuality, it's probably really just a genealogy. There's not a we don't have to find some secondary fulfillment in every passage of Scripture.
Right.
So I think we do have to be careful not to, like, overly insert Christ in places where he's not apparent. Like, the scripture as a whole is not, the sum of the scriptures is more than the individual parts.
Right.
And I think sometimes this idea that we have to find Jesus in every passage is ignoring that fact that the sum of scripture is Jesus, the aim of scripture is Jesus. That doesn't mean every single individual passage is about Jesus, like, specifically.
And I think sometimes, and you guys correct me if I'm wrong, I think sometimes my experience has been is that as the Holy Spirit does illuminate the scriptures, what we find is that he places Jesus in the proper context in places that are somewhat surprising to us. So, for instance, like, Paul is talking about, you know, the Israelites going through the wilderness and testing the rock, and they're saying that that rock was Christ.
Yeah.
I remember reading that and thinking, oh my word, that rock was Christ. Like, that's not a plenary thing. In the sense that, like, it's not plain on the face. And like you said, we sometimes are so desperate for, we want to try to, like, throw in or imbue some sense of, like, different codes, when really maybe the just the straightforward meaning is that God, his sovereignty, is bringing about all these generations into the birth of Christ to deliver his son to us, and that we should just step back and marvel at that, and that's enough.
That should be enough.
And there is a difference, like in that passage in 1 Corinthians, there's a difference between an allegory appearing and allegorizing.
Yes.
And that, I think, people can get confused sometimes as to what that means.
Yeah, and, you know, I think, too, like my motto is, when something's confusing, just read a little bit more, right? And even when you read that passage, like, Paul kind of portrays this rock in the wilderness, like the rock is following the Israelites around. So even just reading that and going, wait a second, the rock didn't follow the Israelites around, should clue you into something. And this goes to what you're saying about, like, knowing the scriptures, right? We've talked about this sort of, like, theological spider sense, and there's a biblical spider sense too, where you should, if you kind of pickle yourself in the scriptures, you should be able to see a passage and go, all right, well, Paul's saying that the rock was Christ. So did he really mean that, like, the physical rock was like a pre-incarnate form of Jesus? Well, what can I find in the text that might help me understand that? Oh, well, he's imaging this Christ, this rock, like Christ is following the Israelites around, and I know that historically the rock didn't. So there's more going on.
Right.
But then on the other side, you know, there's passages that talk about the pillar of flame and the pillar of cloud as the Holy Spirit in the midst of the Israelites. Well, is there something that would tell me it's not actually the you know, a theophany of the Holy Spirit? Well, no, there's not. Like, everything in the text seems to be really straightforward. So I think really, like, immersing yourself in the scripture daily and not just reading. You know, I love Bible reading plans. You and I were talking about this today. Like, Bible reading plans are great, and sometimes you need those to keep yourself on track. But sometimes, especially if you read the thematic ones, you end up spending a lot of time in the same ones. Like the Dr. Horner reading plan, where you do, like, have you heard of the Dr. Horner plan? You've heard of the Dr. Horner plan? The Dr. Horner plan basically is, there's 10 different categories of scripture, and you read each of those repeatedly over and over again. You read 10 chapters a day. And what I've always been frustrated about that is that that kind of gives you this impression that certain sections are more important than other. Like, you read Acts every month, but you only read Genesis every 5 months. So, like, why is Genesis less important than Acts? I guess you can make an argument. But if you do that kind of reading plan, then what you find is you're so much more familiar about some things than you are about others. If you've only ever read Exodus one time for every five times you've read Corinthians or Numbers, I suppose, you're going to run into this problem where you don't spot that issue that the rock didn't really follow them around in the desert.
Right.
Yeah.
And that way we kind of get back to the grammatical historical. We take it literally until the literal meaning presents a contradiction or is illogical.
Yeah.
Right. And I mean, some of this is just a matter of words and context, right? I mean, God is delivering to us something that is infinite in a way that it's very finite. And so we're going to wrestle through what these things mean and by faith try to apprehend them in a way that is consistent with the texture, or the texture, consistent with the scripture, and then provides, that's why it's a texture, and then provides a way for us to also build application of that. So I'm curious, like, what do you see as like kind of a big error that people then generally make? Like, is there one that stands out with this kind of thing, with the, either questions of prophecy, understanding the allegorical versus the not?
Well, I mean, I guess it's a combination. Certainly there's people who misapply certain texts that are promises to Israel uniquely under theocracy and apply that to individual situations where they'll quote it to someone else. I think people misunderstand the priesthood of the scriptures. In other words, this doesn't mean everyone is entitled to just their own opinion as to what they read.
Right.
And so my opinion is just as good as your opinion, and we don't need to really discuss it because we're each kind of receiving what God wants us to.
Yeah.
I think the other danger with this discussion, and we're not saying this is what we're dealing with primarily, but if you begin to say, well, that wasn't the author's intent, that opens a door for you to say that really is not applicable,
right,
or for you to reinterpret it to a context that you want to apply it to today.
Yeah.
You know, there is obviously contextualization in Scripture, but that's not contextualization when you purposely saying, because in a sense, we're not the author. God is the author, and God chose to reveal it as he chose to reveal it.
Right. And I think that most of the people who are listening are of course going to be on that same page, and they come to the Scriptures with a great sense of fidelity. They want to practice what is a proper understanding of what they read. So, and maybe we've kind of covered this a little bit, but how do we do that then? I mean, for the casual person who's just saying, I want to open my Bible, and I'm captivated by the Word of God, and I want to be so careful to understand it rightly. And I think there are people, and I've been this way myself at some points in time, where you can become almost just so obsessed that to not get it wrong, that you're just so focused on, I just want to understand it properly. Yeah. I know there's so many different opinions about what these things mean. How do I know which is right? And I want to understand all these passages properly. Yeah. I don't want to get caught up in distractions or red herrings. So what are like simple ways? I mean, when you're talking to your congregation, when you're teaching people, what are kind of simple ways that we can start to do that process, feel confident?
Yeah.
That you always talked about reading like the full counsel of God, reading the scriptures. Are there other things?
Subscribe to the Puritan Journal. Tell Joel Beakey. No.
Do you have some sort of beat on a commission that we don't know about, or what's going on here?
Speak to Joel.
Yeah. Are you and Joel like best friends now?
I haven't met him. He's a great guy. But I would say first, encourage people when you're talking to them, ask questions like why they might think this way. You know, I mean, not be just dogmatic and be like, well, you're wrong. But to get them to tell you why they think maybe the Bible is just something that nobody ever agrees on.
Yeah.
And probably often they're very extreme things, sound bites they've heard from other places. Obviously, just get people first reading the scripture. Try to be reading it systematically. You know, not just taking a passage here and a passage there.
Is there, is there a right or wrong way to read it systematically? So when you say systematically, what do you mean?
I don't think there's a right or wrong way. As long as your goal is to get through an entire book or an entire genre of scripture so you get a feel for just how it relates maybe to other parts of the Bible.
Okay.
I would also encourage, I mean, probably more a pastoral perspective, encourage someone into you know, go through some of the reasoning why there are these different conflicts here. What is that the issue? So even helping some people realize there are issues Christians can disagree on. I mean, that's one roadblock for some people. They don't think Christians, if you're Christian, you should never disagree with another Christian.
Right.
And so we have to help. And that's a sensitive subject even for mature Christians who still sometimes can be very dogmatic about certain matters of indifference.
Right.
You know, kind of helping them understand conviction, but being intelligent to examine the scriptures always, be open to that. I like how it's been said, and I think it's true, even for all of us here, hopefully over the years we've known Christ, our theology does change some.
Right.
Yeah. Like we're grounded in the basics, but maybe we begin as we get older to realize those hills that we would stand and die on are not as many as we once thought they were.
Right. The question is, how do we get there faster, right?
Yeah,
right. Yeah, we like, want
I was just thinking, when you were saying, like, there's some Christians that think that they should never disagree with another Christian, all I was thinking was, well, those guys are not online. I don't know where they are. But I mean, that's the thing, especially in reform circles, and it's kind of germane to this question, is trying to figure out, well, how do we get that kind of maturity, or is it the kind of thing that can only come through time as God works in progressive sanctification?
Well, yeah, ultimately is a work of the Spirit in conjunction with, I'd say, the reading of His Word through being a part of a local church and hearing the preaching and teaching of the Scriptures. It's a part of process. I don't think any of us ever fully get there until we go to be with the Lord.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, my experience has been it takes a bit of getting beaten down. Like, you know, I remember when I first got into like Christian Facebook groups, and I have this real distinct memory of a time that I basically like didn't know who I was talking to. And it was like, I was in a Facebook group and it was some dude who had like a massive PhD in Roman history. And I was in like this apologetics group. And I said something like, well, of course Quirinius had the census. Don't you know anything? And this was like a debate group. He was an atheist. He said, well, actually, I did a PhD in Roman history in the first century, and there's no record of Quirinius doing a census during that time. And I was like, oh, dang. And I remember like distinctly the next time that I got into a conversation, there was a part of me that was like, I really need to recognize that, like, I don't know everything.
Yeah, right,
and there are people out there that know more about a certain topic than I do. And I need to be cognizant of that. And you know, honestly, like, this guy's wrong. The Bible tells us that Quirinius did a census in the first century around, you know, during Herod's reign and during Augustus' reign. We know that. That's true. But I have to be able to, like, flex and like, not flex, like not a strange flex, but, like, be flexible to recognize that, like, the approach you take to a person has to recognize who they are. And this subject actually comes up in apologetics with Jewish people, mm-hmm. with Muslims who are familiar with the Old Testament, and then also with atheists who depend on Jewish and Muslim apologists to attack Christianity on the basis of the Old Testament.
Right.
So you'll run into a lot of times where people will say, yeah, Isaiah 50, you know, I don't remember the passage top of my head, but they'll bring up the fact that Alma doesn't always mean virgin. And that's like their silver bullet. Yeah,
right.
We'll see the New Testament took this out of perspective, and you have to be able to account for the fact that when Isaiah was talking about the virgin who will conceive, all the evidence, the linguistic evidence, he probably was looking at a particular person and saying, like, this is what's going to happen, because that had to give Hezekiah comfort. Mm-hmm. Hezekiah. Right.
Yeah,
it had to give Hezekiah comfort. And it's telling Hezekiah, you know, 700 years from now, there's going to be a baby born in Jerusalem. So take comfort in that. That doesn't help him with his immediate issue, which is the context of the passage. And Hezekiah seemed to take immediate comfort from it.
Right.
But at the same time, even as early as the Septuagint, they changed that word to Parthenon. They changed it to a word that only means virgin, and specifically understood it in reference to the Messiah. So we have to take those and be able to be flexible with our approach, but also understand, like, we're not the first people to deal with this.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's William Perkins in Art of Prophesying has a section where he talks about, like, we don't need to reinvent the wheel. Like, trust the scholarship that's come before you. Be critical, be discerning, but realize, like, we don't have to go back to the drawing board to refute Arianism. Like, that was done for us at the Council of Nicaea.
But see, the issue, the term with the virgin and the Hebrew verse, then, like, we're applying everything we just talked about. Well, Mary, in its context, says, I don't know a man.
Right.
clearly she knew biology 101.
Yeah.
So that helps us understand that the emphasis there was someone who has not had any sexual relationships.
Right.
Yeah.
So I think that's a good example of tying this together. When you're talking about apologetics, it reminds me, you know, we're all familiar with 1 Peter 3:15, that a lot of podcasts like this one, it's apologetics to other Christians.
Right.
Right.
You know, and how do you do that in love and realize these are good questions? I mean, I find that anyone, if, you know, if they ask a question, you're like, yeah, that's a really good question. I've thought about that. Like, that just immediately disarms any kind of thought, like, where you're, you know, you're ready to come at me to just shoot this down.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, I think that's all helpful, because we talk about this a lot, that the idea that as Christians we should be the most loving of all brothers and sisters and be willing to have difficult conversations, to challenge one another, but to not be hateful or argumentative or obstinate about it. Right. If we're going after something because we're trying to understand what the scripture's saying, we can keep that forefront, because it's so easy that it starts forefront and then the conversation can devolve into either name calling or just saying, you don't understand, or you're not as well read as I am. And so I think this idea, it starts with reading the full counsel of the scripture. As much as you can get yourself in that rhythm of reading and study. And I think sometimes we put almost too much emphasis on trying to have, you know, supplementary resources. Yeah. Those are all helpful, but they do not replace what you just talked about, Dad, and this idea of understanding how the scripture speaks of itself. And it takes us in somewhat full circle, like speaking of the Psalms, you know, when we get to the crucifixion and Jesus quoting from the Psalms, he's quoting that verse, why have you forsaken me? I mean, clearly, I would say he's sending a message. He's speaking in a way that the Jews at the time would have understood that he was quoting the Psalms.
We hear
that, and we just think that's an amazing expression of Christ on the cross. And we have to be quick. Somebody that sometimes has to remind us, oh, well, Jesus is also quoting, but their culture was so steeped in all of the Old Testament. But that was the common language of, they would have heard that and said right away, here's Jesus imbuing meaning. He's actually reaching back in a way, but in the reaching back, he's almost like pushing it forward. Does this make sense? Like, there's like a time continuum there almost, where he's like, let me just remind you that this was as true then as it is right now, that it was the fulfillment.
So in that sense, even though we talk about the new covenant is a better covenant than it is in Christ, that immediate first century audience had an advantage over us generally because they knew the Old Testament.
Right.
Yeah, that's well said. Yeah.
Well, and one of the interesting things about that passage, you know, when you think about how Christ is using it, the question always goes to, like, well, was Christ really forsaken by God on the cross? And like, you can discuss that, and there's of different course, ways to resolve it. And Tim Keller had his little fiasco on Twitter where he wasn't trying to be a Petropassionist, but he ended up sounding like it. But then you can go so far to the other side where James White is saying, yeah, Christ wasn't experiencing any God-forsakenness on the cross, that he was just quoting the Psalm. And in reality, what he was doing, I think, was, even on the cross, he was crying out to the people who are hearing, saying, I'm the Messiah.
Right.
Trust in me. Like, remember that psalm that you all know is about the Messiah, that you wonder how it can be that the Messiah is going to suffer on the cross. This is it.
This is that time.
You wonder what it means for the Messiah to have his hands and feet pierced. This is it.
Right.
Like, come trust in me. Look to me. And, you know, even like in John, there's this new show called Christ in Context that Kevin, who's been on Steady Anchor podcast a bunch of times, is doing. And he was just talking about John 3:16. And he was talking about how, if you just read John 3:16, right? This is why it's important to read whole sections of scripture. Mm-hmm. If you just read John 3:16, you get off track. But if you read the whole passage, the whole context, embedded in the verse before that is the fact that not everybody is saved, because everyone's already condemned.
Right.
And it's Christ looking to Christ, like they did to the serpent on the pole, is taking away their condemnation. It's not preventing them from being condemned. It's taking away condemnation that was already theirs. So even something like that, the New Testament takes... And this is why type and shadow is so important, right? Both the London Baptist Confession and the Westminster Confession have this robust category of type and shadow, and we handle it a little differently. But this idea that everything about Christ in the Old Testament was in this sort of shadowy form. It was real. It was there. It was caused by a real thing, right? A shadow is not fake, but it's not an exact representation.
Right.
And this idea that, like, the things that are directly about Christ are there in shadowy form. Right, the serpent on the pole was about Christ in shadowy form.
Right,
but it was teaching the Messiah, or the Jews, that salvation comes from outside of themselves, and it comes from something that there's no reason why looking at a bronze serpent on a pole, which is actually something they probably shouldn't do in normal circumstances,
right,
somehow was their salvation. Well, this trusting a man condemned as a criminal being executed for treason against the state and blasphemy is not something you should do in ordinary circumstances. But Christ was preparing them to say, I'm going to reverse your expectations. Even though I told you about them in advance, here's even just one more hint that things are not as they seem. You have to trust me.
Right. Right.
So could a bigger problem be that for that, I'm speaking very broadly, that for the majority of Christians, a lot of what we're talking about, they're not even concerned about this.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
Their biblical illiteracy or just kind of, you know, knowing patchwork scriptures, that they might listen to this and be like, well, you know, that's fine. You want to debate that, but yeah, it really isn't important.
So yeah, is that something, do you say that because that's something that you see from time to time, that there is a, like, really a lack of putting first things first, and this is one of the things that should be first?
Well, I don't know if I would say it's, well, the first would be the biblical importance of interpreting scripture correctly.
Yeah.
So I guess I would say, again, I think we've covered extremes from those who are going to make something that really should not be a dividing issue of Christian unity are going to do that. And then the other extreme is, let's all just get along and not, we don't have to worry about these things.
Yeah.
It'll all pan out in the end. Like, you know, that's a dangerous extreme as well.
Right. I thought you were going to make a pan-millennialism joke there.
No, it's not going to do that.
I'm the odd man out right now as the only millennialist at the table.
That's true.
It's true.
How's that feel?
Fine. It's all going to pan out in the end. So.
I really thought that's
good.
You
feel fine about being wrong.
Well, Dad, there are some things that shouldn't divide us. I heard someone say that one time.
I'm sure a very wise person.
Well, with that said, I think this has been the definitive conversation about hermeneutical application.
Something or other, yeah.
Lots of ground. Would you agree, Dad, this has been the definitive conversation?
Sure. Which probably means, though, again, let me remind the audience, I haven't been on since episode 18.
Yeah.
And I thought that was a meaningful conversation. So, hopefully it's encouraging everyone to ask questions, send them in. You know, the fact that people are saying, I really want to understand this, I don't want to misinterpret scripture, is an indication of spiritual growth.
Yeah.
And then I think to rest in the ministry of the Holy Spirit that he is given to lead us, as John says, into truth.
Yeah.
So we don't have to be fearful that, oh no, if I'm relying on the Spirit and the Word, I'm going to go off into some tangent thing, as long as we genuinely desire and have others around us to help balance that out.
Well, so maybe as we close, you can weigh in on something that Tony and I have kind of, I mean, we feel confident in this, but we speculate about it. And as we try to have people who are listening as part of this conversation join their voices in and ask questions. But sometimes, as you know, in Reform circles, asking a question can seem like you're expressing weakness, like you don't know as much as you should, or that you're afraid to ask me because somebody might come down on you a little hard and say, oh, you're just wrong, you got off base. So get a sense from you, like, how do you feel about when people ask questions? What is that? You kind of said that you saw it as a sign of spiritual searching for the, you know, not only the correct answers, but a sign of maturity of wanting to know the scriptures very closely. But I mean, how do you interpret that? When people ask you questions.
Oh, I'm encouraged by it. I try to encourage them, to put them at ease, because I think there is a sense. I sometimes will say to a group of students, you know, if you have a question to ask and you're kind of embarrassed, say, you know, I have a friend who is wondering. Or, you know, say something different.
Hashtag asking for a friend. And,
you know.
That's so good.
I think that's the thing, because in a lot of church settings, I think we'd admit, people, questions really are not encouraged.
Yes.
I mean, if it's not where you were taking the lesson and someone asks something, I mean, I'm sure we've all caught ourselves doing things like that. And the reality is, even as a pastor myself, I think sometimes we get in the mode where we just want to give people the definitive answer. And sometimes there isn't a definitive answer, or there's an answer with, you know what, I'm still wondering about that. I was listening to, what's his name, Tom Schneider, New Testament scholar, and he was talking about, you know, end time views, millennial and premillennial. And basically, I'm saying, you know, when I teach this, I say, you know, here are the strengths of these, and I'm still not really sure.
Yeah.
And I thought that's really refreshing to hear that from someone like that's very knowledgeable of certain books, But he's saying, you know what? Our knowledge of Scripture is not exhaustive.
Right.
Should we always be growing, but it's never exhaustive.
Yeah.
That's a good way to say it, that there's a sense in which we want to be confident in what we're knowing and understanding, and yet be at the same time always humbled by the fact that we can't exhaust it. That exhausts us in a sense, like our ability to understand it, but that we can't have an exhaustive knowledge. So I think you've just started a trend, Dad, for us, hopefully. This is what we should do, is like this, because this is actually really good. It gives people the excuse to ask any kind of question, I love this, without feeling any kind of shame or sense that it's weak, by just saying, I'm asking for a friend. Like, that should be the code. Like, that gives you license. That gives you liberty to say, like, ask whatever you like.
I would just clarify that, probably. Make sure, if you are going to ask a question, that you're open to listening to the answer.
That's good.
Response.
That's good.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny, because Dad has no idea that that's, like, a super common, funny, like, goofy thing people say online. Mm-hmm. They'll ask a dumb question, an intentionally dumb question, and then they'll say, asking for a friend. But it's true. Like, and you know, people write into us all the time. They ask questions to us all the time. Jesse and I don't have all the answers.
Absolutely.
But what I love about it is people feel free to do that.
Yes.
But if you ever don't feel free to do that, then email us and tell us not to use your name. Like, we're happy to just ask the question without including your name if you feel embarrassed about it. I'll tell a funny story about questions. When I first became, I think I've shared this before, but when I first became a Christian, the band DC Talk was really influential for me. And that,
why do all your like these stories about DC Talk?
Well, that's why it was such a big deal.
We can't go like more than two episodes without coming back to DC Talk.
But that's why it was so important. That was why it was so exciting for me to meet Michael Tate at the airport. Was it was like DC Talk was this huge deal. And the song Jesus Freaked, there's a line that says the Pharisees freaked when they heard him speak. They're talking about John the Baptist. Yeah. And for the longest time, I thought that the only context I had for what that word could possibly mean was that it sounded a little bit like the word Pharaoh. And so I assumed that was like some weird archaic plural for the word Pharaoh. Mm-hmm. And I never asked. Well, I remember I was in confirmation. I was in ninth grade and they were talking about witnessing to your friends. I had no idea what that meant. And I couldn't find it. This was before the internet was a really big deal. I couldn't find anything. And I was ashamed to ask. So when I finally did ask, I felt stupid because I was like, everyone around me knew this. So if you ever feel silly asking a question, first of all, like, ask the question. It's better to ask than not to ask.
For sure.
But we're happy to answer anonymous questions. You know, we bring up Jimmy or Jackson or Diego, people who are kind of our frequent flyers, and we love that. But there are people that send us questions once, and that's all they ever do, and we love that too.
Right.
Maybe I know you're probably going to close here and then wait for applause. But I was thinking it was something Rabbi Zacharias said about behind every question is a questioner.
Yes.
So one thing worse than hearing a question is misunderstanding the question and answering something that they're not even asking.
Yes.
Right.
So important to make sure if they ask you a question, maybe try to rephrase it and say, is this sort of what you're asking, or is this what you're kind of thinking? And then that gives you time even to think a little bit before you respond.
Yeah.
And that's a helpful word, because I think so much, thankfully, of like the questions that happen in the Facebook group or that get sent to us are coming from a place that it's not just abstraction, that somebody's really not even just wrestling, but they're just trying to understand something and put it into practice in their life in a way that's a little bit more volitional. Mm-hmm. And I love those types of questions. It's not just about like, well, help me break down this pragmatic, like esoteric dogmatic idea, but I'm really trying to be a follower that's very closely tied to the Lord Jesus Christ in my relationships, in my talking, in my expression online. And I've come across this thing and I'm trying to understand how I can put it into practice, into application in a way that's more profound. And
so is the best response, say if you're asked a question, is the best response to know that your answer will lead to another question?
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah,
that's, I think so.
I think so, because like as we've talked, like how many episodes now? Apparently 195. This is 195.
Yeah,
it happened. All that time, I think so many times we'll come to a subject and we wish we had like another 2 hours, right? Because we've processed something and then thought, oh, but what about this?
Yeah.
And then we should talk about this. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I think, behind every answer, there's five more questions.
Yeah.
And a good answer does lead you deeper into the well.
Yeah.
And the beauty of the scripture and, of course, of the Lord Jesus Christ is that is a well, or that is a mine that you can endlessly go to for jewels and keep turning out all of these treasures, looking them over and over and over again, and it will never be exhausted.
Yeah. You know, I wanted to make sure that we said this before we wrap up, is the fundamental answer to this question, right? The whole question is, how do we handle passages that are in their original context seem to be something historic, But then, you know, either the New Testament or later Old Testament reflection seems to pull that forward to be about Jesus. And the question that I always ask when I encounter that is, instead of asking, what did Paul mean? What did Matthew mean? What did Moses mean? The question should be, what does the Holy Spirit mean? What did the Holy Spirit mean when they inspired such and such a person? And on one level, you know, there's this old adage, I forget who said it. I think for some reason, Gordon Fee sticks in my head. He wrote How to Read the Bible for All It's Worth. In one level, this is true. He said something like, Paul couldn't have meant what Paul didn't mean, or Paul couldn't have meant what Paul didn't know. But on another level, that's not necessarily true. And here's part of why I say that. And this is a biblical reason, right? That's the other thing is, our first interpreter of the Bible should be the Bible. Right. And so in Hebrews 3, verse 7, the author of Hebrews is bringing all these Old Testament passages to bear on the ministry of Christ. And he says, therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, and then he quotes a psalm, and it's a psalm of David. But the point is, it doesn't really matter what kind of psalm it was. The Bible treats everything in the Bible as though the Holy Spirit is the author.
Right.
So we are on an excellent footing to ask the question, what did the Holy Spirit mean? And I think there is a tendency, especially, you know, not to call any particular person out, but I'm going to call a particular person out as we usually do, but like the John MacArthur school of interpretation tends to, I think, miss this element of it. He tends to limit himself so much to the historical grammatical method that I think he sometimes misses nuances in the text.
Sure.
And there, I mean, that's to his strength. He's an expert at historical grammatical exegesis.
Right.
But I think when we limited ourselves to what the human author could possibly have meant, we sometimes end up treating the Bible like just another human book.
We have to.
And then we forget that like the Holy Spirit is the primary author of Scripture. Right. And we're on scriptural grounds to say that.
Right.
So I think, you know, this is a great question. And like we're talking about, the best questions lead to more questions.
Right. Yeah.
The best questions drive us further into the Scriptures, further into our shared Reformed tradition, further into our confessions. And that's really the way we want to go, I think, is to look at the wisdom that God has embedded in the church prior to us, and then above that, and especially above that, in the Scriptures themselves as the chief interpreter of Scripture.
Right. So could we say with that, then every question anyone might have about the Bible is important, although its implications may vary. And that kind of reminds me to help redeem Spurgeon from an earlier hermeneutical talk, that there's a scarlet thread that runs through the Bible.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. That's well said. Well, as you've seen, Dad, we're really horrible at ending the podcast because I think we mentioned we use all these verbal cues, like we're drawing it to a close, wrapping up. But we'll bring it. Yeah. Well, we'll bring it to a final end.
I have
here.
A friend who was wondering, how do you close this?
Dad, you're a natural at this. You should have your own podcast.
Yeah, you really. And with that said, so I think because you are both the pastor in residence and our esteemed guest on this particular episode, you get to have the final word. So, is there anything you'd like to say to kind of usher us into the end here on this topic?
I would say, please keep your questions coming. And if you have questions about the Puritan Reform Journal, also email those in. But it's been fun.
Thank you for being willing to come on again. You're welcome anytime. Like I said, you're a pastor in residence. So
yes.
You're on the payroll, which is zero, unfortunately. Yeah, we appreciate you being on the payroll very much.
That was a lot of fun.
Yeah. Well, until next time, honor everyone.
Love the brotherhood.
This is where you say love the brotherhood.